What we'd like to do today is there's an echo, but okay, it is recording, so we are fine. Thank you. And then I'll just go ahead and share the screen. We have covered so far the chapter on the equation of fluid dynamics. And we suggested that they allow us for very, very little analytical, exact analytical solutions. We were able to derive Euler's equation and Bernoulli's equation. And 90% of the problems in fluid mechanics really are amenable to be using the Bernoulli's equation. So we covered that. What we did there is identify what are the basic equations that govern fluid mechanics in general so that we can analyze different reactor accidents. You could see here the loss of coolant accident, the debris beds cooling, steam explosions. You'll find that we are going to build simple models, analytical in fact, that apply those conservation laws of fluid mechanics. We suggested that because the Navier-Stokes equations are very, very complex, we cannot really solve them on any computers without using some form of finite difference and the discretization of the fluid flow. What was very important in what we have done is that we suggested that we conserve three quantities. We conserve the mass, which we call the conservation of mass equation. We conserve momentum, and we called it the equation of motion. It really says that force is equal to mass by accelerations, but in fluid mechanics, you cannot measure forces. So what do we measure? We measure pressures, forces per unit area. This is measurable, say, with a pressure gauge in any kind of instrumentation or equipment. And the third quantity that we conserve is conservation of energy. And when we are going to deal with these different problems here. We are going to simply apply those conservation relationships, and you'll see that we can get some very good insight into very complex problems with very simple assumptions in general. If we cannot apply those simple conservation equations, then we get the help from computers and supercomputers and so on, solving the differential equation that describe the conservation of mass, conservation of momentum, conservation of energy. And since we have five variables that we deal with, position, speed, velocity, specific energy, and so on, we need an equation of state that relates three of them, like PV is equal to RT, the ideal gas equation. That would be an equation of state. Or it could be the gas tables, the steam tables. The steam tables, and the steam tables in that case also give me a relationship between the pressures, the specific volumes, and the temperatures. So today what we are going to try to do is analyze an accident using very simple assumptions as a way for you to learn, other than using supercomputers, which I have shown you how to do it last time, the field of computational fluid dynamics, how to analyze an accident. And the most important accident in this type of analysis of fluid flow is the loss of coolant accident in that case. The loss of coolant accident is the design basis accidents of most reactor concepts, meaning that when you design those systems, you assume that that particular accident, the loss of coolant accident, is going to happen, and then you design the system in such a way that if it happens, you can survive with it. The terminology is to mitigate the effect. So what we are going to consider is a small break loss of coolant accident and see how we can analyze it for a pressurized water reactor, in contrast to the boiling water design in general. So we'll create an analytical model that describes to us the rate at which the water in the core, if we do not provide cooling would evaporate, and the core in that case would be uncovered. And if it is uncovered, then the cladding will interact with the water, the steam in that case. It will literally burn. It will oxidize. When you say oxidize, it's almost like burn. So the metallic cladding becomes like brittle. It becomes a powder. Zirconium oxide is a powder, and then the fission products would be released to the environment. If we do not provide cooling, you can melt the core. And in fact, that is what happened in the Three Mile Island accident. So our analysis today, and you'll find that other courses have adopted that model from our course, I asked for permission. This is a small break loca. The small break means that a small pipe has leaked the coolant to the reactor system. Notice that nuclear reactors are different than other types of power producing systems, in that even after you shut down the chain reactions, you have to deal with the decay heat, or what they call after heat. This would be heat generated by the fission products for a while, even after we shut down the plant itself. So in that case, we analyze the different phenomena that happen in the core heat up process. Fission products are releasing the heat through different phenomena occurring at different scales of temperature, as you could see here. The operation of a pressurized water reactor is rather low. It's 350 degrees Celsius, and that is the at which the water is not boiled, but it is maintained at a pressure of about 2,200 PSI, or pounds per square inch. So this is the cladding temperature in the PWR. Now, if you start getting an accident, obviously you get an accident by an increase in temperature when either the coolant has leaked from you, like a pipe has broken maybe as a result of an earthquake. And if you lose the pressure because the system is pressurized, you'll find that the water now that is under pressure sees the atmospheric pressure and it flashes into steam. So as it flashes into steam, you are losing your coolant. You are losing the process of cooling the core, and you find different phenomena ensue from this. That process of depressurization, as it's called, is the same as what you would see if you open up the lid on the radiator in your car, because the coolant in the radiator of a car is in fact pressurized. And as it loses the pressure, it would suddenly turn into steam, and that's what would hit you in the face if you are not cautious and wait for the radiator to cool down before you open it up. All right, now if we do not provide cooling, this is called the adiabatic heating accident in the pressurized water reactor. So we'll put in our interest in analyzing it and see how it affects the design of a PWR. Now that doesn't mean that's gonna be happening every day on every pressurized water reactor. This is a hypothetical accident that we consider and try to provide engineer safety features so that it doesn't happen. Now, if we do not provide cooling, so what happens in that case? The cladding in which that contains the fuel would start swelling in volume because you get internal pressure to be built up from the gases that come out from the fission process. So in that case, for instance, if you have iodine as a fission product, at room temperature, iodine is a liquid, but when the temperature increases, it becomes a vapor, and that increases the pressure inside the cladding or the tubes that contain the uranium dioxide fuel. Some fission gases, such as krypton — that's not kryptonite, by the way, there is no element that's called kryptonite, it's only Superman's movies — but krypton is a noble gas. It's like helium, like neon. Noble gases do not interact chemically, but it is a fission product. You'll find that krypton and xenon can be released if you start building up pressure in the cladding, and then it starts leaking. And one important isotope, really, or element is iodine. iodine-131 and iodine-132, it starts leaking from the fuel. Now, if we release iodine to the environment, it deposits itself on vegetation. Cows feed on it, say, if it's released in the environment. And then the iodine has a very interesting feature. It seeks our thyroid gland. So if you could see here, you can touch your neck and you find the gland there in the shape of a butterfly. This is the thyroid gland. It controls many functions in our body. The iodine basically seeks that gland. So if that iodine is radioactive, oh, well, it generates little cancers. We call them the thyroid nodules is the name for it. Something interesting about the thyroid nodules is that to cure them, you use, in fact, radioactive iodine. So you inject a person who has a cancer in the thyroid with radioactive iodine, and that kills a little iodine nodules or the cancers in the thyroid. It can happen, in fact, to people who have been exposed to radiation, like the senior President Bush and his wife, Barbara Bush. Both of them got what was called Graves disease, which is little nodules or cancers in the thyroid. And they were given that radioactive iodine, and that cured them. The United States Homeland Security, in fact, has ordered medication. They spent $295 just last week ordering medication for the possible radiation, fearing the state of nuclear war in the Ukraine. In fact, the United States is under an emergency state right now. Have you heard about DEFCON process? Have you heard about it, anybody? Did you? DEFCON is readiness condition. So they get rid of the readiness in the center, and that becomes DEFCON. And Europe right now is under DEFCON number 2. And the United States is under DEFCON number 3 for a fear of a nuclear war erupting from the war in the Ukraine. And we have nothing that you can do with this right now, but it has to do with the, of course, the thyroid gland being exposed to lots of iodine. One way of protecting against that iodine being absorbed by the thyroid gland in the case of an accident is to get pills that contain potassium iodide. So the potassium iodide goes to the thyroid gland, and now if there is radioactive iodine from a nuclear accident that we are mentioning here, it doesn't go to the thyroid anymore. Now, other than the release of those gases now, iodine in the form of a gas, you get solid reaction between the stainless steel and the zircaloy. The stainless steel is used for spacers that keep the fuel elements away from each other. You'll find that the clad starts swelling because now the pressure has increased inside it. The gases have exerted pressure on it. And a process called ballooning that we have to deal with later as another accident could block the flow of the coolant. And now it becomes a positive feedback effect. You have a high temperature that causes ballooning of the fuel. The ballooning blocks the flow of the coolant, and it makes it even worse. Now, one interesting aspect, and that's something we saw in the Fukushima accident when we'll study the Fukushima axis, is the interaction between the steam and the metal, the zircaloy. Zircaloy here is a simple L, by the way, because it's the name of an alloy of zirconium, chromium, and nickel. And it is chosen because it doesn't absorb many neutrons, zirconium, as well as that it resists corrosion. But when you have steam interacting with any metal, the metal oxidizes. So if you have iron and you pass steam on top of the iron, you form the iron oxide, and that oxide, the oxygen is taken out of the water and hydrogen is released. In the Fukushima accident, in fact, the steam interacted with the surface of the zinc alloy and generated lots of hydrogen. And if you may have watched the videos of the accident, that hydrogen is very reactive with the air. So we had several hydrogen explosion in that case. When you release hydrogen and you burn it, oh, you're adding more heat. So you'll find that the temperature now from 1450 degrees Celsius increases to the 1500 degrees Celsius. That would be, of course, generated, as I suggested, from the decay heat. Initially, the decay heat is going to be about 8% of the energy released from the fission reaction, but it decreases very rapidly. For if you cool the reactor for a time period of 24 to 48 hours, then you can cool it and you can recover from it. If you can't, you get the situation of the Three Mile Island, Chernobyl, as well as Fukushima. The oxidation process embrittles the cladding, the zinc alloy, and if you have steel alloys in the spacers between the fuel elements, that also melts at 1500 degrees Celsius. The zinc alloy and steam reaction may become autocatalytic. What is autocatalytic? It means that as you increase the temperature from the reaction, the excess heat gets you into a feedback, positive feedback effect. The higher the temperature, the more the reaction. So that is described as autocatalytic, feeding upon itself unless the zinc alloy is quenched by immersion in the water coolant. Unless we turn on pumps to bring in some coolant water, then that reaction gets worse as it proceeds all the way to 1650 degrees Celsius. Now, if the temperature increases further, if we do not provide cooling, you'll find that the zinc alloy cladding melts and the fission products from the ceramic UO2 fuel becomes significant above 2000 Kelvin. And if you reach a temperature of 2700 Celsius in that case, both the zirconium oxide, which is zirconium that has burned or oxidized, as well as uranium dioxide fuel melt, and you have a melted core. Now that happened in the three accidents that were major in the nuclear industry. The Three Mile Island had a core meltdown. The Fukushima had a core meltdown in one of the reactors at least, and as well as the Chernobyl accident. So the reason is the decay heat. And the decay heat is a process that happens because the fuel is a solid fuel. Some people suggest that if we want to avoid that type of an accident, and we can, we have to evolve from using solid fuels to using liquid fuels. If you use a molten salt, for instance, you can continuously extract those fission products and let them decay out of the core of the reactor, and you can eliminate the process of the decay heat. Unfortunately, that process, that evolution did not happen, even though it happened in the fossil fuel industry. We know, for instance, is that around 1919, Winston Churchill changed the fuel that is used in the British fleet, and the England controlled the whole world by its fleet. If somebody objects to its opinions, they'll go with the fleet and bomb them. So their fleet was running on coal to run the steam engines for, of course, propulsion. And when oil was discovered around the First World War, immediately Winston Churchill changed the boiler's fuel to a liquid, from a solid to a liquid. So I think this is something that we need to have in the nuclear industry. In that case, we would evolve from using solids to using liquid fuels. It didn't happen yet, even though many people advocate the process in general. Now, let us say that if you have a reactor accident, how much radioactivity now from those fission products from the fission reactor are released. Notice that we are studying here what we call a postulated accident. It's not something that happens in every reactor. And the source is the report that you mentioned earlier in the semester, the WASH 1400. It's called the Reactor Safety Study. The author is Norm Rasmussen. He was the head of the Department of Nuclear Engineering at MIT, and this report basically has analyzed what are the accidents that can happen in a nuclear power plant in a realistic way. So let us see what kind of fission products or gases can be released, according to the WASH 14 reactor safety study release in general. We have the noble gases, we mentioned those already, krypton and xenon. Those do not react chemically, so we don't worry about their chemical reactions because they're noble gases by definition, but they emit gamma radiation, the krypton and the xenon, so the effect from them is a whole body radiation, and we'd like to study their biological effects maybe in another chapter. You also release another form of fission products in a chemical that we call in chemistry the halogens. The halogens, we mentioned the iodine, but the bromine is in the periodic table in the same column as iodine, so they behave in the same way. We call them the halogens. We also release metals, and there are different types of metals. The alkali metals are the cesium and the rubidium. And we release other metals, tellurium, selenium, rubidium, T-E-S-E, rubidium. We release from chemistry also, the terminology comes from chemistry, alkaline earth. This is strontium and barium. And the strontium, the same as iodine, are two very important isotopes that we need to study in more detail. You release noble metals too, like ruthenium and molybdenum. And we release some of the rare earth elements. The rare earth elements, they're not really rare, but they're very hard to extract. They need very high temperatures to be extracted from their ores. In that case, we talk about lanthanum, samarium, promethium, and we call them refractories, meaning that they really need very high temperatures to melt, and this would be the zirconium and the niobium. In that case, you'll find that different percentages are released depending on the temperature at which we reach in the accident. So if we get just a fuel clad gap interaction, 3% only is released of the noble gases. But if you get a complete meltdown, you release 90% of them. And if you get vaporization, oh, it's 100% of them released. And the oxidation as a percent would be 90 multiplied into A, the fraction of score involved in a steam explosion, and B, the fraction of inventory remaining for the release through oxidation. A steam explosion, and we'll analyze it in more detail later on, did happen, in fact, in the case of the Chernobyl accident. A steam explosion happens when a molten metal, in that case, what we call the corium material, which is a molten core, falls down through the pressure vessel into water that would be under the core. And the design of the RBMK-1000 involved in the Chernobyl accident was a very bad design in that they had water right under the core. So they ended up with a monumental steam explosion. One of the four accidents in the four reactors involved in the Fukushima accident had a very, very notable explosion that was not just a hydrogen explosion. You'll find that the material from the core really was ejected up high in the sky. It's closer to a steam explosion than anything else. That has not been acknowledged by the TEPCO. TEPCO is the Tokyo Electric Power Company in general. So let us look at the accident, which we call the hypothetical large break, loss of coolant accident in the PWR. Please try to remember LOCA stands for, or is the acronym for, loss of coolant accident. You'll find that it moves in different phases, and the actions of the operators have to change according to the phase that in which the accident is proceeding. Over 0 to 20 seconds, we call that phase a blowdown phase. In the large break, loss of coolant accident, meaning that you get what is called a guillotine break in one of the coolant pipes, you'll find that this would be happening in one of the cold legs meaning the pipe that brings in the cold water from the feed water heater into the pressure vessel and cooling the core of the reactor. You'll find if you have a break in that pipe, the system very quickly depressurizes. Now remember that it is operating at 2,200 pounds per square inch. If you depressurize it, you get the same effect as you get if you open up suddenly the cap on top of your radiator. The coolant that's pressurized in the radiator, it is not the steam, it's in the form of a coolant. It sees the atmospheric pressure, so it flashes into steam and the system depressurizes. To a lesser extent, you can see it if you shake a can of Coke, because the liquid there contains dissolved carbon dioxide, and you open it suddenly, you get depressurization, and the can of Coke would spray in your face. At that point, in 0 to 20 seconds, and you could see here that's a very rapid type of progression, a two-phase steam and water mixture is formed by the flashing of the water into steam. The mass flow rate of the water and steam mixture definitely becomes slower than the mass flow rate of a liquid that goes through the core of a pressurized water reactor. And in that case, the depressurization slows down. Within 10 seconds of the 20 seconds here in the blowdown phase, the flow from the high pressure injection system, automatic, remember that's one of the engineer safety features for the pressurized water reactor. It's designated as HIPC. The operators pronounce it at HIPC, but it's really HIPS, high pressure injection system. It senses that the pressure has gone down and it starts injecting into the core coolant to replace the coolant that would have been vaporized and lost from the core. Another engineer safety feature is what we call the accumulators in pressurized water reactors. These are tanks that contain water under pressure, nitrogen pressure. If the sensor senses that the pressure decreased below 20 atmospheres, the water is automatically injected into the core of the reactor. And that could be sufficient to recover from the accident. You provide a coolant when you lose it through depressurization. However, this is not what happens in accidents. Accidents are not just a single event that we can predict and we can design against its occurrence. And if it happens, we can, of course, mitigate its consequences. What happens in accidents is that they become a sequence of events. For instance, you get that starting blowdown, and then it is followed by, some equipment malfunction. Then it's followed by some design flaw. And then it's followed by an error by the operators, and it becomes a serious accident only in a way that we really cannot predict. From 20 to 30 seconds, you could see how fast this is happening now. You'll find that you get an upward flow of the steam in the downcover annulus, which surrounds the core of the reactor. And this upward flow prevents the accumulator water from getting into the core and cooling it. The coolant water bypasses the upper part of the reactor, so that part of the reactor is not cooled, and the water simply flows out through the break in the pipe on the side of the reactor. Within 30 to 40 seconds, now you start really refilling the core from the coolant that it has lost. Remember, it has lost it for because the water is, the coolant is at very high pressure, and suddenly it sees atmospheric pressure, so it turns into steam. If the system pressure decreases enough, the emergency core cooling water from the emergency core cooling system, remember we did the analysis in the risk assessment part of the course of what are the costs for the emergency core cooling system in the chapter on cost benefit analysis, you'll find now it can ingress. Ingress means bringing water into the lower plenum of the core. And this is if it is, the pressure is still very high. If the pressure is decreased now because the reactor lost its coolant, then the low pressure injection system called the LIPC is initiated. And the high pressure coolant injection, when you use pumps that operate at high pressure, you can only have a very small flow rate. But if you have a pump that operates at low pressure, you can have a much higher flow rate. This is characteristics of pumping systems in general. At 23 seconds, you start filling the lower part of the reactor core with water, and the water starts rising into the core. Within 250 seconds, then you are having a reflooding phase. The core would have been totally uncovered and dried. You provide it with coolant now. Some of the cladding may have been damaged. The fuel elements could have ruptured, releasing the fission products. In the reflooding place, the fuel elements are rewetted from the bottom of the core to its top, and the excess emergency core cooling system is now overflowing through the break in the piping, the inlet pipe. In the American designs, we consider that the inlet pipe is the one that gets the break for the analysis of that accident. In the German designs, they consider both the inlet pipe and the outlet pipe in the design. They consider that, say, you get an earthquake that breaks the two pipes. If you reflood the core, now you end up with what's called a debris bed, fuel that has oxidized and formed basically a rubble, call it, instead of debris bed, and you have to continue cooling it beyond 250 seconds, otherwise it will melt. If it melts, it goes through the pressure vessel through the core, finds water under the core, under the pressure vessel, and you can have a steam explosion. So luckily, it didn't happen in all our accidents except Chernobyl in Jena. Some process happens in this type of an accident. It's called the steam binding. And during that rewetting process and reflood phase in the PWR, the steam binding phenomena can affect the reflooding phase. Binding meaning that now you have the steam and the water stuck together, and instead, and pumps are efficient at pumping liquid, not a mixture of steam and a liquid. The same situation happens in the BWR to a certain extent. This is a description of the hypothetical large break loci in the BWR. Both of them are what we call the design basis accidents for the PWR and the BWR. Now, these are the design basis is based on large break loci, meaning that you have a pipe. And the steam pipe from the BWR, at the, I took classes when the Clinton plant west of town here was under construction. The pipe that carries the steam is 1 meter in diameter, that large. And they take the steam up to the top of the reactor, then they bring it all the way down, then they raise it back again to the turbine hall to allow the nitrogen-16, which forms in boiling water reactors because the water absorbs a neutron, the oxygen in it turns into nitrogen-16. It has a very short half-life, but it is radioactive. So you give a long pass for the steam before you send it to the turbine so that any engineers or maintenance people in the turbine hall would not be affected by gamma radiation. The small break loci in the PWR is the it's not the design basis accident, but it is the most common accident that would happen. And this is in fact what happened in the Three Mile Island accidents, reactor accident. It was not the design basis accident. The pipes did not really break as a result of an earthquake. What happened in that case is that a valve on the top of the pressurizer opened up. And as it opened up, the steam started leaking and the water started leaking from the valve. The valve opened, and instead of reseating itself after the pressure decreased, it remained open. So in that case, the coolant continued being lost from the top of the pressurizer. There was no break in the piping, and this is considered the most probable accident that can happen in the pressurized water reactor. And that's why we are going to try to analyze it in more detail. Other than the emergency core cooling system and the accumulator tanks that we mentioned that would provide cooling, there are other alternatives. In typical PWR, the emergency core cooling water is injected in the coolant cold leg into the reactor pressure vessel only. So let me show this with a diagram here. So you have here our pressure vessel, and you have a pipe here coming in, bringing coolant from the feed water heater. The core would be here. and the water goes down and then rises up and then exits from what we call the hot leg. So this is a cold leg, and this is the hot leg. All right, so now the design basis actions, as I said, in the PWR in the United States is that this cold leg would simply break at the guillotine break, meaning from an earthquake. So you find that the coolant now is leaking from this area. The coolant injection in the United States comes in the cold leg right here. So you inject the coolant water for the high pressure and low pressure cooling from the cold leg. So it may find its way out of that break in the whole thing. So in that case, you find that the German designs have injection not just in the cold leg, but also in the hot leg. So assuming that one or the other breaks, but not both. So depending on the design, you'll find that you have emergency different cooling system in alternative. So in the typical PWR, the emergency core cooling system is injected in the cold leg into the reactor pressure only. And as I suggested, I keep emphasizing it, in the German design of a PWR, the emergency core cooling system is injected in both the cold and hot leg as an extra safety measure. And why is that? If you travel in Europe, you'll find that their power plants are very, very close to their population centers. Europe is a very, very crowded place compared to the United States. Here we keep our reactors away from the population centers, maybe in other countries like China, for instance, but in Europe, they keep their power plants, and France, they keep their power plants very close to their population centers generally. This alternative in the German designs claim to lead to a lower peak temperature in the case of a large break loca. In the case of a small break loss of coolant accent, it will provide faster depressurization is claimed. Now, in the newer designs that are designated as the AP1000 and the AP600, this is the latest designs of pressurized water reactors. AP stands for advanced passive, and the 1000, try to remember the acronym so that you can read in the literature about it. That is 1000 megawatt electric, and a smaller size one is the advanced passive 600 megawatt electric. Those two designs are licensed to be used in the United States. They are designed by the Toshiba company from Japan and the Westinghouse company in the United States, and they are under construction. In fact, in China, at least one is in under construction in China, Thailand, and maybe South Korea. So what is the phenomenology then? What happens in the small break loss of coolant accent in the PWR? Following the initiation of the small break loca, example, a valve being stuck open, you'll find that the primary system is depressurized. As it is depressurized, the automatic control system senses that the pressure has been modified. And these are sensors right in front of the operator. An operator of a nuclear power plant has in front of him no more than basically six measurements. And if he needs other measurements, he has to send his aide back into the control room to read the data for him. The automatic control system senses the pressure drop. The control rods are inserted. So the fission power, which could be 3000 megawatts thermal, is terminated. And that shuts down the fission power. However, a typical of nuclear power plant is that still the fission products are emitting radiation and they remain there generating heat. And we'll have a whole chapter on how much heat is generated so that we can use it in the design of the cooling system. And we call this the after heat, or we call it the decay heat. Initially, it's 8% of the fission power. So if you have a 3000 megawatt thermal power, let's say 10%, you still have to deal with 300 megawatt thermal of power from the fission power decay. If you do not provide cooling, eventually you melt the core, you melt the fuel, and you even can vaporize it in general. If the pressure falls below 100 bars, bars is stands for barometric or barometric pressure or atmospheric pressure, the high pressure coolant injection pump pump water at high pressure. But if you pump water at high pressure in a pump, we said that that gives you a small flow rate. As the pressure falls to 70 atmospheres, the hottest liquid in the primary circuit flashes into steam. The water in the pressurizer now, that's a part that pressurizes the water coolant in the reactor itself, totally vaporizes, so now it becomes a total void. Steam bubbles form in the primary circuit and settle in the upper part of the reactor. So this is still at high pressure. So what do you do as an operator there? You want more cooling to come into the core. So you intentionally depressurize the system. You open up those valves on top of the pressurizer. And like in any pressure equipment, if you have a pressure cooker, you must have a valve in it so that if the pressure exceeds the design pressure, it releases the steam rather than having all the piping and the whole system break apart. Steam collects in the upper head of the reactor as a result of depressurization. It cannot escape. The water coolant leaks quickly and drains pipes within 250 seconds. The steam generators eventually become voided. They would have only steam in them, not quite voided of liquid, but they get filled with steam. So not really voided of water, but not steam. The water in the core vaporizes, and a mixture of water and steam bubbles rewets the upper wet of the core. And because as an operator, you'd have depressurized the system in that case, then you find that the low pressure coolant injection system comes into play. And in that case, you can have a much higher flow rate of cooling. And the depressurization now allows the activation of the accumulators and the low pressure coolant injection system. The core is rapidly reflooded. And in the longer term, for a time larger than 350 seconds, you get the decay heat is extracted in the same manner as the large break loss of coolant accident. All right, so that happened, in fact, in the Three Mile Island accident. So here we are going to have the ambition of analyzing or getting some kind of simple model of that loss of coolant accident. What happens in that case? So in that case, let us say that we have water now wetting the core. And what we want to figure out is how long does it take for the water in the core to be vaporized and at what speed the core is being uncovered from the water. So we can calculate the volume of the water of the liquid per unit length of the core by taking the diameter of the core. You take pi d square, you get the area of the core. Pi d square over 4 is the area, d is the diameter. And then you take 1 minus alpha, where alpha is the mean void fraction of the steam in the core. And then you multiply it by 1 minus the fraction of fuel in the core. That gives you a volume of the water in the core. If you eliminate the steam and you eliminate the fuel in that case. And that would have interesting unit. It would have meter cubes per unit length. So we take a unit length, meter cube per meter. Now you'll find that the water is going to be heated by the decay heat. And we'll have a whole chapter on how much that heat is going to be after we cover that chapter. You'll find that the decay heat can be the thermal power of the reactor, P sub TH, multiplied into the fraction of the power fraction after shutdown. Immediately after shutdown, it is about 8%, multiplied into delta, that's a fraction of the fuel that is submerged under water. Now, the mass water evaporation rate is going to be the power from the fission products, the decay heat right there, PdK, divided into the latent heat of vaporization. L is not the length. So in that case, if you divide the heat release in watts by the latent heat of vaporization, which is how much heat is needed to vaporize a kilogram of water, you find yourself with watts, which is joule per second, divided into joule, cancels out, and you end up with a kilograms per second of water that is evaporating. You are evaporating the decay heat divided into the latent heat of vaporization. The volumetric heat rate would be that m dot here divided into the density of the water, the coolant density in kilograms per meter cube. So your volumetric evaporation rate, if you take that m dot kilograms per second, divide into the density as meter cubed per meter cubed per kilogram, then you find that the V dot here is how many cubic meter per second is evaporating of the coolant in that case. And there you find something interesting here now, the last step in the calculation. The core uncovery rate would be that volumetric evaporation rate in meter cube per second divided into the volume of water per unit length, which is meter cube per meter. And omega here becomes the rate of how fast the core is being uncovered. So it has, it is in meters per second. And let us plug in some numbers here to simulate the Three Mile Island accident. let us take a PWR, like the Three Mile Island accident, 3,000 megawatt thermal. We say that half the core is already uncovered into the accident. The mean void fraction 0.5, the fuel occupies 40% of the diameter of the circumference, the area of the core. The core diameter is 3.6 meters, typical of a PWR. The radius is about 2 meters. The core height is 4 meters. The system pressure is 85 barometric pressures. Latent heat of vaporization at atmospheric pressure, 1.46 million joules per kilogram. And let's take the coolant density because it contains void. It is not 1,000 kilogram per meter cube like water is 1,000 kilogram per meter cube. Let's say it is contains void, so 700 kilograms per meter cube. We'll see that after shutdown, the decay heat power decreases very rapidly, as we said. So you'll find that the fraction immediately 1 second after shutdown or after the accident occurs, you'll find that the decay heat is 6.5 of a fraction of this, the fission power. Within 1 hour, you could see it's only 1.4%. Within 1 day, let's say within 10 hours, it's only 0.75%. It decays very, very rapidly. So let us plug in some numbers in the equations that we derived. The volumetric volume per meter is plug the alpha of the fuel, the diameter of the core. It's 3 meter cubed per meter. That is the volume of water per unit length of the core. After at 1 hour after we shut down the reactor, that fraction of the decay heat out of the power is 1.4%. So if you take the 3800 megawatt thermal, now notice that is thermal, you turn the megawatts into watts and you multiply by the fraction and the delta would be 1/2. So you find that you can calculate the water evaporation rates as 19 kilograms per second. That is 1 hour after you shut down the reactor. From the fission power itself. The amount of water evaporating is m dot divided into the densities, that's 0.026 cubic meter per second. And then you can calculate the uncovery rate, V dot into V sub L that we derived earlier. You'll find that you are losing 0.87 centimeter per second. So from the height of the core, you are losing about 1 centimeter per second. And now the question that I'm gonna ask you for an assignment, do this calculation, and depending on what is the depths of the water in the core, we suggested that it's half filled. How much time does it take for the core to be totally uncovered, knowing that it is about 1 centimeter per second? Notice it doesn't take too long, and in the pressurized water reactor, but obviously, in designing nuclear systems, we need to do better than that very fast uncovery rate. And this is the whole issue of designing safer and safer nuclear power plants. I'll stop here at the safety design of light water reactors for next time. And have a nice afternoon, everybody. I hope that we are able to record it. I'm not sure. Okay, that's good news, because last time, I'm sorry, I will have to depend on the lecture notes because...